I'm Shane Ross from the Aerospace and Ocean Engineering Department at Virginia Tech. I'm going to be telling you about chaotic dynamics in atmospheric flows and connections with field experiments. What we're going to do is look for the most influential material surfaces of particle deformation patterns and concentration profiles. We're going to use the technique of what are called LCS, or Lagrangian coherent structures, in particular hyperbolic Lagrangian coherent structures. This term was first used by Haller and Yuan in 2000. An attracting LCS is a surface such that any blob that straddles this surface will be attracted to this surface. There are also repelling LCS, where a blob that straddles it will be repelled from it. In general, LCS are surfaces with the largest attraction or repulsion. These can be combined in interesting ways in realistic flows. For instance, in atmospheric flows, the red and the black particles here are being separated by a repelling structure and attracted to an attracting structure. It looks like a saddle point that has been extruded in the vertical direction. Now, it's important to keep in mind these aren't static. They're actually moving surfaces. This is showing a highly exaggerated vertical direction of a LCS passing over Virginia Tech. We can use these for other studies as well. For instance, the ozone over the South Pole, measured by a satellite, this is in the year 2002. The large blue blob in the middle is depleted of ozone. It's the ozone hole surrounded by a polar vortex. And in 2002, it separated into two roughly equal pieces. Now, if we compare this with a computation of attracting and repelling curves high in the stratosphere, we get this. So we have a structure that looks like it's providing the boundary of the vortex. And something interesting is happening in the middle, where we see a splitting event. If we overlay these two, we see that the LCS seem to capture the edge of the ozone hole and also reveal the split. So we have a lot more going on than just a boundary. We can actually see filamentation in and out of the boundary, but the main feature here is capturing the splitting. If we look in detail at exactly how the splitting occurs, we can see air mass growth perpendicular to the repelling structure that grows in the middle. And so you see that the purple and the green were air masses on either side of a repelling structure. One of the most popular and convenient ways to extract Lagrangian coherent structures from a fluid flow is to calculate the finite time Lyapunov exponent field. This is a scalar field that measures the stretching, the maximum stretching, between two points in a fluid flow. Sigma is represented as shown here, where T0 is the initial time. Capital T denotes the integration time, or the time over which we calculate solutions. And lambda max is the maximum eigenvalue of C, the right Cauchy-Green strain tensor. We extract ridges of the FTLE field, and this provides the LCS. So in a two-dimensional flow, ridges will be 1D. In a 3D flow, ridges will be two-dimensional. If we imagine the phase space covered with many circular blobs, the FTLE field measures the maximum stretching of the circle into an ellipsoid. So it gives the linearized stretching. Quick example of a simple flow. This is a double gyre flow. If we calculated the forward time, finite time Lyapunov exponent, we should extract significant features. In this case, we would expect the boundary between these two coherent regions, the vortex gyres in this case. We show the ridge of high FTLE indeed does pick up that relevant boundary. We could apply this to more complicated fluid flows, such as an atmospheric flow. Shown here is the atmospheric LCS over North America, both the repelling in orange and attracting in blue, and you see that they intersect and move in very different ways. These LCS are cores of airborne concentration deformation patterns, or air mass movements. We're going to switch gears and talk about how LCS could be useful for understanding how invasive species ride the atmosphere, in particular plant diseases. There was a hurricane, Hurricane Ivan, in the early 2000s that brought a new crop disease, soybean rust, to the United States. The path of the hurricane is shown in the map in the upper left, where it passed low enough that it was able to pick up airborne plant pathogens from South America and then deposit them on the Gulf Coast of the United States. Soybean rust is a disease of soybean that hadn't been in the U.S. before. So it's an invasive species that was brought on what is arguably a very coherent structure in the atmosphere, a hurricane. So it infected regions on the Gulf Coast, shown here in the map on the right. The cost of invasive plant pathogens is over $40 billion per year in just the U.S. alone, so diseases of staple crops like soybean, wheat, and corn. We'll focus on a disease disease of wheat, Fusarium head blight. It affects the regions shown in red in the upper right. These are the wheat growing regions of the U.S. It's caused by a fungal spore that has a elliptical banana shape, roughly 10 microns long. And this spore has led to $3 billion in losses to the United States economy over just the past decade. At Virginia Tech, we performed a field experiment spreading a disease from a known source. We took 5 acres of winter wheat, provided some diseased stalks, and inoculated the field with the disease so that it would be released. Then we put out dozens of samplers at different distances from our diseased field. In this figure on the right, the diseased field is the little yellow square, and we had these samplers at 100 meters downwind, 250 and 500 meters, aligned in the prevailing wind direction of our source. Using a instrument in the middle of the field, we were able to measure the strength, how much was being released as a function of time over a 2-week period. So you see there are these spikes. This would be when a lot of the fungal spores are being released. It's quite uneven. From that, we can use a Lagrangian stochastic model to find out an estimate of where this would be deposited. So what you see on the right is a plume that's changing as the wind direction is changing. And wherever it would hit one of those sensors, shown as a black dot here, we would have a measurement. So we could predict the amount of disease based on this study over local distances. This is showing a dispersal kernel, or the amount of disease deposited as a function of distance going out to about 1 kilometer. Now that's just locally what happens, so within about 1 kilometer. What happens on larger scales? Well, if these spores can go higher into the planetary boundary layer, they can travel many, many kilometers, perhaps hundreds or thousands of kilometers, until they're either removed by rain. These are also living, so they need to be viable when they land on a susceptible crop and are affected quite a bit by UV. I'm showing a view of the field site where we did measurements of just what was in the air, not just from any local source we made, but from other places as well that travel on air currents to our sampling location. We used aerial sampling drones flying at around 100 meters altitude, and this is work with the David Schmale group at Virginia Tech. Different types of drones were used. There are fixed-wing drones like the one that's shown here that has petri dishes that open when they reach an appropriate height. We could also use quad rotors or multi-rotor drones. The fixed-wing drones have the advantage that because they need to move at high speed to stay aloft, they're able to measure a high volume of air in a short amount of time. And when we reach a desired height, we can open up the petri dish sensors and sample what's in the wind at that height. We can collect these colonies of Fusarium spores, and that's a genus, so we could actually break it down by species and see what the population was of this Fusarium as a function of time. We do this over many, many days, and we can build up a time series at a single sampling location. What I'm showing here is just the total spore concentration in the air across all species. Of most interest to us is when there are these changes that happen over a short amount of time. This is called a punctuated change, and we show here a classic punctuated change where there were low values and then high values and then low values again. How do we understand these? When we have the drones aloft, they are sampling on one side of an LCS. We could look at the times in which an LCS was passing over our sampling location. That's shown here at the bottom with these vertical red lines. And you see that they're on either side of that region of high concentration. If we look at an aerial view of both the attracting and repelling LCS, our sampling location is the small open circle. The black dot is the air mass that we collected that gave a high concentration. And you see that there are these filaments of high concentration that are moving across, and that seems to correspond with what we sampled. So in cartoon version below, we have our sampling location. We have a region of high concentration that's sandwiched between two LCS. As it passes over our location, we would have a peak in concentration, and then it would go back down again. We saw several of these and were able to do a test of significance, and we found that a punctuated change in the spore concentration was associated with an LCS passage more than 70% of the time. So we conclude these airborne biological agents do follow LCS. To give another example, we could look at the first hurricane of the 2007 hurricane season. This is Hurricane Andrea. If you look at this more carefully, you can identify what looks to be a structure familiar from chaotic dynamics, a homoclinic tangle, where we have what appears to be a instantaneous fixed point, and then we have stable and unstable manifolds of that fixed point. Using the procedure of lobe dynamics, going back to Varad Ramkadar and Steve Wiggins, we can tile these lobes in terms of regions that will get entrained into the main part of the hurricane vortex and those which will go out. So here the magenta is currently in the vortex and should go out. The green is currently outside and should go in. And the purple right next to it should actually stay out. If we color code the atmosphere with these same regions and then let a simulation run, we can see what happens. So we've got our vortex region, our different colored tiles, and if you keep your eye on the colors, you see that they move the way we expected. So the green entered the region and the purple and magenta are outside. We could also look at LCS and finite time Lyapunov exponents in an instantaneous limit, which means we don't need to integrate particle trajectories. We could just look at an instantaneous snapshot of the velocity, v. We calculate these instantaneous structures from the Eulerian rate of strain tensor. The eigenvalues of S are instantaneous Lyapunov exponents, or ILEs, and they are the infinitesimal limit of FTLEs. The repulsion rate is the largest eigenvalue of S, and it gives the repelling FTLE, or forward time FTLE, in an instantaneous limit. The attraction rate, which is the smallest eigenvalue, provides the negative of the backward time FTLE. We could use the same procedure of looking at a ridge of this instantaneous Lyapunov exponent, and we can define an instantaneous Lyapunov exponent structure, which over short times, under the action of the flow, will give us what we would expect. A retracting ridge line will attract blobs that straddle it. To illustrate this on a simple flow, we're looking at a green blob straddling a blue attracting LCS, and we advect all of these forward in time. You see that the green blob straddles it and seems to spread out along it. On the other hand, we could also look at a green blob straddling a repelling LCS and see what happens. And as we expect, it's moving almost perpendicular to it. If we look at the atmosphere on one layer, now instead of 2D LCS, we just have curves. We're looking at a fixed initial time, but decreasing the integration time. And as we decrease the integration time, we don't go to just a uniform field. We actually do converge to something. And this something is the instantaneous Lyapunov exponent. We can extract from any initial time these blue and red curves, which are the attracting and repelling instantaneous Lyapunov exponent structures, and watch how they deform fluid blobs over a short time. In my final section, I'll describe how we experimentally measured instantaneous LCS during a field campaign in San Luis Valley, Colorado. The atmospheric simulation shown on the left came from James Pinto from NCAR, the National Center for Atmospheric Research. And you see there's a lot of interesting structures, especially depending on the time of day. We placed three sensors. Two of them were drones, and one of them was a fixed asset, to determine the gradient of the velocity field at the interpolated point. We're showing an aerial view of the three assets. We've got a drone over here, a fixed tower, and then a drone here, all equipped with weather stations, so we're measuring the wind, the two components of the horizontal wind in particular. We measured the attracting rate using those three velocity measurements, because from that we can get a gradient. So that was given by our sensors, and then compared that with a model given in blue, a high fidelity weather research and forecasting model. And we have pretty good agreement. And it seems that we were able to pick up a feature, the LCS feature that was found near our sensor site. So in summary, LCS, Lagrangian coherent structures, in particular hyperbolic Lagrangian coherent structures, are surfaces in 3D or curves in 2D, which reveal the core of particle deformation patterns in general fluids. Atmospheric LCS can be useful for understanding air mass transport and everything that gets transported in the air. We could also look at instantaneous limits, which reveal the short-time deformation patterns. We've done experiments using LCS to understand spread, and those are ongoing. And there's applications to agriculture, looking at how plant diseases spread, even trying to forecast it. Pollution transport, and also air quality. I want to thank you for your time. You can follow me on Twitter at Ross Dynamics Lab. For further study, you can look at the resources provided here.